Well, hey everyone, welcome back to Anything's Possible podcast, where everyone has a story to tell, a step to take, and with Jesus, anything is possible. Today, we got to have our good friend, John Acuff, on the episode. Now, John is a speaker and an author and longtime member of the Crosspoint family. We just love John so much. And he's been speaking as part of our Frequency of Joy series this summer. But we just take a deeper dive into this idea of soundtracks, the soundtracks that our minds play. And this episode is going to be so helpful. Actually, statistically, he talks about in this episode that like 99.5% of us struggle with this. And so this is something that applies to everyone. I think this episode is going to be super helpful for you. And there's some really practical things we can do now to start rewriting, replaying those soundtracks in our mind. So let's jump in with John Acuff. Welcome to Anything's Possible podcast. Well, man, thanks for jumping on. Last time we did this was over Zoom. That was kind of lame.
Yeah, yeah.
Although I'll never forget you made the Ring Central joke. That was one of my favorite jokes.
Like, what was the joke?
Well, we were like, we're doing these Zoom interviews, but our church uses Ring Central instead.
Yeah,
and you're talking about being like the Kmart of the...
Yeah, I felt like I needed to tithe more. I was like, what is going on? Like, I know anything's possible, but good things should be possible too.
You went off on like a 5-minute rant on Ring Central. That was just brilliant.
That sounds like something I'd say.
I loved it, man. Well, I appreciate you coming back on. I know anytime you get invited somewhere twice is a big deal for you.
It is. I was telling my family about it all week. All week I've been like, this is the one. This is going to be the thing that breaks us.
I appreciate it, man. You've been at Crosspoint for a long time. And speaking this summer as a part of our Joy series. And yeah. So we've been wanting to have all of our speakers on just to kind of go a little bit more in depth, talk through Joy, but then also maybe hear a little bit more of your story, what you can't say on a Sunday you don't have time for. So let's start there, man. Like, tell us how did you get to be John Acuff? How did this happen?
Yeah, Crosspoint was the first church I ever spoke at.
Really?
Yeah, so this was probably 2009 maybe. 2000, okay. Yeah, probably 2009. And so I
came up. But you're already speaking, you're just in first church.
I was speaking, but I hadn't spoken at a church, and it was probably like a year into me speaking and writing blogs, and I lived in Atlanta at the time, so I drove up. It was over at the Charlotte campus, and so it was fun. So yeah, we've been around Crosspoint for a long time. Then we moved to Nashville 11 years ago.
Okay.
And so we considered this home for a long time.
Yeah.
And 11 years, you feel like a local because everybody's been here for 11 minutes.
Yeah.
So it's
an eternity in Nashville time, 11 years.
Totally.
You guys, I love that you've just been like locked into that Franklin campus. And I like, we've talked about this before, but that's a campus that my family and I attend as well. And I love the vibe of that campus, man. Yep. It's, you're there for, and I mean, no disrespect to anything else programming wise, but it's the community for me. It's like the people, like
the lobby. It's the before and after to me. Mm-hmm. We love it. And the building is fantastic. It's super fun. But then just seeing like, and Justin, having Justin as the campus pastor
He's
is
phenomenal.
So great.
You guys were probably buddies before he was campus pastor, right?
Yeah, we've run for probably the last 2 years. And so when he was put in the position, I was thrilled. But I mean, I was dropping my kids off to him every Sunday because he was doing kids programming.
That's right.
So so a lot of people might not even know that. Like, he served the church for a long time in a lot of unseen ways.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, I'm a huge Justin fan.
Yeah, he's an incredible job.
I love that guy.
Well, and I tell him all the time, I love that my family is under his pastoral leadership
here,
because he's the guy that will stop in the lobby and pray with you, and he's just so locked in spiritually. So he's been doing a phenomenal job. I've been wanting to ask you and talk to you about this idea of joy around your new book that just came out, the soundtracks idea, because this is something that I've actually wrestled with a lot in my life, is just the battle in the mind, like getting my mind right and how that perspective shapes everything. So I want to dive into that. I'm curious, though, as you're writing books, you're speaking, you're podcasting now, which that's a newer thing.
Yeah, right? I have a podcast called All It Takes Is a Goal. I'm a huge goal nerd. Mm-hmm. And so I love helping people finish the goals they start, because 92% of goals fail.
Yeah.
And I think that what I like to say is starting is fun, but the future belongs to finishers.
Yeah.
And so it's fun. I get to geek out with a bunch of people finishing goals.
You got a finish course that you do, help people walk through that and kind of do that. I need to get into that, man. Because I've always said.
I don't know about that. Like we've talked about this.
Okay.
Like you lost the weight and kept the weight off. Like that's a thing. Like that's a real awesome accomplishment. Like, that's super encouraging to so many other people, to yourself. So
thanks
so I bet you
that,
finish
man.
More goals than you give yourself credit for.
Really? That's encouraging to hear, because I've always labeled myself as like I'm a starter, an entrepreneur, I get things going, hand it off, but I didn't connect the dots on that, so I'm
100%
encouraged by that.
Yeah, with
sure.
the progress we have, the hardest time seeing is our own. And that's why we need community.
Yeah. So you taught this last Sunday on joy at CrossPoint.
On July 4th.
On July.
Yeah, thanks
tell
for that.
Them what you said.
Thanks for that spot. I immediately texted Drew and was like, that is the youth pastor spot. So to the 7 people that saw that sermon, I am so encouraged and glad that they used me in that spot. I mean, that the servant leadership for me to take that spot is through the roof.
Humility.
Drew was like, hey, nobody else wanted that spot. You think every other speaker you asked passed on July 4th?
I just thought, who's the most humble out of all of our speakers this summer.
No, that's real talk. That's real talk. Anything's possible.
That is so fun. I'm just glad that you didn't let me slide on that at all.
No,
you're like,
no,
I
but
get
we're
the July 4th.
We're friends.
That's what happens when you're buddies, when you attend the church.
And we videoed it. So it's like, and I knew that would actually help.
Right.
So like it would, I joke about it, but I knew that would be helpful.
Right.
What's up, CrossPoint Online? My name's Paul, and I get to serve you as the online pastor. We are so glad that you're joining us here today. Hey, maybe you're new to church and you're just trying to figure out this whole church thing. We're really glad that you're here. And maybe for those of you who join us every single week and you call CrossPoint your home church, we love that you're here with us every week. It brings us so much joy to know that you're joining us. You know, CrossPoint is a church where everyone is welcome, and we're learning that nobody is perfect, right? And because of Jesus, anything is possible. We love having you here with us today. And maybe you're looking to start a conversation with us, or you're looking for prayer, or you wanna join a group. You can always go to crosspoint.tv/everyone's welcome and find all those things and a whole lot more. Or you can always go to one of our chat rooms. We have a lot of great volunteers who are hosting those chat rooms, and they would love to help point you to resources, encourage you, maybe even pray for you if that's what you're needing. But they would love to do that. And hey, let's go ahead and get it started. Go into the chat room and tell us where you're joining us from today. Well, I can't go any further without saying happy 4th of July. We are so glad that you've chosen to join us on this Independence Day. I hope that you're having plans to spend time with your friends and your family. I know for me, I'm gonna be behind the grill. I'm gonna be hanging out with my friends, and you know I'm gonna be shooting some fireworks, okay? So we have lots of fun things happening, and I hope you do too. I love that we can all kind of come together in this moment and for us to sing together and to worship together. You know, we can praise God for all He is and what He's done in our lives. So let's all join together and worship Him in this time.
Well, hello, everybody. Hope you're doing so, so good. Today, we're really excited to teach you a new song, and it's just about the topic of God's goodness. And I just think that's the best thing we could sing about, because that's exactly what He is. I grew up kind of like thinking, I knew that Jesus loved me, right? My mom and daddy told me so. The Bible told me so. But I kind of wondered, like, is God actually good? And the longer that I've lived, the longer that I've known Him, the most thing that I'm confident about most in life is that God is so, so good despite our circumstances. And there's a line in this song that just says, if you've been where I've been, then you know what I mean. He's just that good. And that is my story. Like, honestly, that's my story, that He's been so good to me in my life despite circumstances. And so just want you to sing this song with us, teach it to you, and let's remind our hearts today who's in control and who is so, so good to us. All right, here we go.
There's a home for the prodigal, love that chases the cynical. There's a well for every thirsty soul, come and dream. On the last breath of a criminal, hear a song from every hymnal. Oh, He's still working miracles, come receive. brand new beginning.
He's just that good.
Joy that's never ending.
He's just that good.
Oh, he's just that good.
So I'll stay still.
Lord, there is so much more you promised. In silence the noise, and tear down the walls within us, 'cause there are greater things you promised. So Lord, take us deeper, Lord, take us farther, give us the faith to step out on the water, help us believe even more.
Than to hear all the amazing stories of the way that Jesus is making a difference in people's lives. Here at Crosspoint, we are all about helping people find and follow Jesus. And I heard an amazing story this week about Calvana. And she is someone who watches every single week online, and she lives in Washington State. So I did the math, and that's like 2,000 miles away from Nashville. So thank you so much for joining us. Shout out to all of our friends in Washington State. We love that you guys are joining us. But Calvana heard about Crosspoint because someone invited her to watch online. I love that. And so she started watching because she was in a point in her life where life was kind of feeling a little bit heavy for her. She had just her daughter had just been born, and then she was in a new city, so she was looking for a job, and her maternity leave was starting to end. And so as she was watching, she really clung to this phrase that she heard that was to pray big prayers. So she started praying these big, anything's possible prayers for her life, because she needed God to provide a job and childcare for her daughter. And so she was praying those prayers. As she's praying those prayers, she's doing the work. She's putting a resume out there, and she's trying to find a job. And so she puts a resume out there a bunch, and she's praying and asking God to show up, and he does. He shows up, and he gives her 3 opportunities for a new job. And they're not just just any job. These are remote jobs so that she could stay home and be a mom and also provide financially for her family. So God showed up in an amazing way, and that's such a cool story. But the bigger story is the way that God is moving in Kelvana's life, and that she is learning about the power of prayer and how to lean on God and to trust him with her life. And that is an amazing thing that we all are a part of. Those of you who give generously to Crosspoint, I just want to say thank you, because you help stories and lives being changed like Kelvana's because of your generosity. And so I thank you so much for the way that you give every single week. And hey, maybe today is your day to give. And so I just want to encourage you that you can always text in the word give and the amount to 276-398, or you can always go to crosspoint.tv/give and you can make your contribution there. But thank you so much for the ways that you guys give generously. It's amazing to see God move through you. Well, today we are in a series called The Frequency of Joy. And last week we had our friend Lisa Harper with us, and she was hilarious. Am I right? She was hilarious. She is so funny and such a strong teacher of God's word, and so encouraging and inspiring. And I know that you were encouraged and inspired by her story. But today we have our friend John Acuff with us, and he's gonna be sharing in just a few minutes. But before we get started, Pastor Kevin has a message for us.
Hey, Crosspoint, it is so good for us to be able to worship together. And whether you're with us online or you're with us in person, I want to take us back to what we talked about last week. We said, hey, this summer we're going to have an opportunity to get to hear from some of our favorite communicators and authors. And this series is called Frequency of Joy. And that's my hope for you, is that this summer your frequency of joy would increase. But also think about like those old school radios where you got to work to dial it in. We're talking, how do we dial in the presence of God and live with more joy in our relationship with God and with other people? And then how do we do that more frequently? And really, so much of this goes back to the way that we think. And I can't think of anybody who'd be more helpful on this topic when we talk about how we think and how it relates to joy than John Acuff. Now, John's a great author and a great friend, and he's part of a small group of guys where we run together and we pray together on Saturday mornings. And it's frustrating having John as a running partner, because while we're running, he's just dropping wisdom, and I don't have anything to write with. But fortunately today, you can find something to write with. Grab a Sharpie, grab some eyeliner, something to write with, and take notes. So John recently wrote a book called Soundtracks, where it's talking about how we change the way that we think and replace those old ways of thinking with new soundtracks in our lives. And today he's gonna lead us into how we can change the way that we think to find more joy in our thought patterns. And so we're gonna tune in today. You see what I said? Let's tune in. Frequency of Joy.
I need to start today with a bit of a confession. I am a goal nerd. Now, we don't have a Comic-Con or a Dragon-Con type convention that I'm aware of. But if we did, the hotel gym would be full of intense type A people fighting over the treadmills at 4 a.m. because sleep is for the weak. Who needs sleep? I bet there'd even be some people doing that rope toss move. Have you seen that one? Have you experienced that one? Where somebody grabs a rope in each hand, and then they do this really quickly as an exercise. I think it's a fine exercise. I personally don't know when in your life you'll need that exact skill. I mean, I get that if I learn karate or jujitsu, it might get me out of a jam someday. There will be a situation in life where a throat chop comes in handy, but the excitable double rope whip, it feels limited in its usefulness. Oh no, a hot air balloon at the Santa Fe Balloon Festival broke loose and is floating away with some orphans and puppies inside. Is there anyone here, anyone in the crowd, who can grab both of these moorings and do this really quickly? And then you step out of the crowd and go, I was made for this moment. That particular exercise has never been a goal of mine, but I have tried every other type of goal you can think of. 1 year, I ran 1,000 miles. Another year, I read 100 books. 1 year, I hired a table tennis coach because I wanted to see how good I could get at ping pong. Raise your hand if you've ever hired a Team USA sanctioned elderly man from mainland China to throw hundreds of ping pong balls at you, yelling kill, kill, kill in Antioch. Just me? I'm the only one who did that? That's what I thought. Cool. I've done business goals, health goals, spiritual goals, sales goals, relationship goals. I even tried drinking a gallon of water every day for 2 weeks straight. I did that one because the water cartel, like people who are online on Instagram who are really into water, talk relentlessly about how amazing water is. If you'll just drink more water, your skin will get healthy, your stamina will improve, and you'll be able to float a little bit. Like, you won't full out fly, but if you drink a gallon of water every day, you can hover higher than magician David Blaine, but lower than Peter Pan. That's the level of hover you get. That's what I was promised. So I did that for 2 weeks straight. I drank an entire gallon of water. Do you know what I learned? Do you know what that particular goal taught me? The location of every bathroom in Franklin, Tennessee. That goal was not helpful, but I do love goals. I've written books about goals. I have a podcast about goals called All It Takes Is a Goal. I'm a goal nerd. Why? Because I believe that a goal is the fastest path between where you are today and where you want to be tomorrow. If you want to accomplish anything, a goal is the best approach. So what if joy was your goal? That's what we're talking about in this series, joy. I think that's an amazing goal, to have more joy, to be more joyful, to enjoy life more, to enjoy God more, to enjoy your family more, your job more, your neighborhood more. I want that for my own life. But there's a problem. There's something surprising that gets in the way of all that joy. Do you know what it is? Overthinking. Any overthinkers in the crowd today? If you have to think more than 3 seconds about your answer, congratulations. You're an overthinker, just like me. But what does that word even mean? What does overthinking really mean? Here's how I would define it. Overthinking is when what you think gets in the way of what you want. That's what it is. At the simplest level, it's when what you think gets in the way of what you want. There's something you want. You can see it. You know it. But all this extra thought gets in the way. And here's the key. It's not a personality trait. It's the greediest, sneakiest form of fear. Overthinking steals time, creativity, productivity, and joy. Have you ever judged an idea as too dumb to even write down? You have this idea in your head and you go to write it down, or maybe you go to type it into Evernote or your computer, and before you even capture it on a piece of paper or in your phone, you decide it's not worth it? That's overthinking. Have you ever told yourself an elaborate story about why someone didn't text you back? Are they mad at me? Did I disappoint them? Did they misinterpret my texts? Let me go read my text again. Should I have put more exclamation marks in it to let them know I'm light and breezy? If I used as many exclamation marks in real conversations as I do in text messages, people would think I was screaming directly at their faces constantly. If you've ever thought that, if you've ever gone back and read a sent email, like a week after you sent the email, you went back to your sent folder and read that, that's overthinking. Have you ever done that? I bet you have. We've all done that. There's nothing you can do to change it, but you still spend time reading it. That's overthinking. Were you ever slow to pull the trigger on a decision you wanted to make? You wanted to make sure you had all the information first. You want to have all the information. That's overthinking, because we haven't lived in an all world for 100 years. You'll never have all the information. But is overthinking really that common? Is it that big of a deal? Is it something that really gets in the way of our joy? I got curious about that. So I did what I always do when I get curious about an idea. I commissioned a research study with a PhD named Mike Peasley. He's right down the road at MTSU. We asked 10,000 people if they struggle with overthinking. 10,000 people. And you know what we found? More than 99.5% of them said yes. And that was before 2020. I mean, let's be honest, 2020 was catnip for overthinking. If anyone in the world wasn't overthinking, they are now. Why? Because everything is a thing. For example, I met someone a few weeks ago, and when we started to talk, they reached out to shake my hand. And right before I shook his hand, I thought, should I refuse? Is that rude to say, nah, I don't do that? What if instead I quickly rotated to give him my elbow? Like, hey, here's an elbow bump. Is that less insulting than a fist bump? Like, which is worse, that elbow or a fist? What if I kick my foot at him? Is that weird? What if I shake his hand and then I immediately dip my entire arm, like up to the elbow, in a giant vat of hand sanitizer, as if to say, excuse me, sir, I just need to scrub off this deadly pandemic you just tried to murder me and my grandparents with. 1 second, if you don't mind. Are other people shaking hands here? I start to look around the room. What does shaking hands say about somebody politically? Like, what does a handshake mean about who you voted for? All of those thoughts went through my head in the second before I shook his hand. Do you know what I thought about 2 years ago when someone wanted to shake my hand? Nothing. But now, everything is a thing. So I started to look into books and research about overthinking, and I was really surprised how many of them said, stop it, just stop doing that, stop overthinking. And that didn't make sense to me, because you and I have the great fortune of living in the age of neuroplasticity. Neuroplasticity, which is the hardest word I'm going to say in this entire sermon, means you and I have the power to physically change our brains by changing our thoughts. Your parents' generation didn't know that they could change the shape and function of their brains. Their parents' generation thought that cigarettes were good for cyclists in the Tour de France because the nicotine opened the capillaries in their lungs for those long mountain climbs. Maybe my kids' generation will be the ones who finally figure out how to make vegan queso not taste like organic sand. Every generation learns something new. With neuroplasticity, the solution to overthinking isn't to stop thinking. Why would we ever get rid of such a powerful, efficient tool? God gave us amazing minds. Wouldn't it make more sense to just run our brains with different thoughts instead of the broken ones? I mean, after all, a plane can drop a bomb or food. A syringe can deliver poison or medicine. A stallion can start a stampede or win a race. The same is true of our thoughts. If you can worry, you can wonder. If you can spin, you can soar. If you can doubt, you can dominate. What if you could listen to the kind of thoughts that push you forward instead of hold you back? What if you could turn overthinking from a super problem into a superpower? What if joy started with how we think? What if that was true? Wouldn't that be amazing? And here's the thing, the Bible actually talks about how we think way more than you might suspect. I mean, take for instance, Romans 12:2. Here's what that says. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. What if being transformed was a process of renewing your mind? What if when you renew your mind, not only are you transformed, but you can resist the pattern of this world and enjoy God's good, pleasing, and perfect will? Talk about some wonderful benefits to changing how you think. And I feel like Proverbs 23:7 is even more direct. As he thinketh in his heart, so is he. The thoughts you have in your heart impact who you are. Your thought life shapes your life. What if, and this is a little bit crazy, what if we could be intentional about that? Here's the good news. The good news is you can. The even better news is that it's simpler than you might imagine. All it takes are some new soundtracks. So what's a soundtrack? A soundtrack is a repetitive thought. I've heard people describe thoughts as leaves on a river or clouds in the sky or cars on the highway. But for me, I think of them as soundtracks. They're often playing in the background of your life. You might not even notice them, but they have the power to change the entire moment. I mean, think about a movie. Think about a movie that opens up on a bright, sunny day with a beautiful house, with a white picket fence, and maybe some kids frolicking in a park nearby. If that soundtrack in that moment is ominous, if the music they play is scary,
everything changes. You suddenly start thinking, there's probably a creepy clown in that sewer. Watch out for creepy clowns in sewers. Don't go in that house. It's quiet. It's too quiet. Well, what happens if they switch it up and they play an upbeat song like Vanessa Carlton's Thousand Miles? Now, it's happy. It's a rom-com and somebody is making their way downtown. Your thoughts are the internal soundtracks you listen to even more than your favorite song. Over the years, you've built a soundtrack about your career. You have a soundtrack for all your relationships. You have a soundtrack that you believe about your hopes, your dreams, your goals, and every other aspect of your life. If you listen to any thought long enough, it becomes a part of your personal playlist. How powerful are soundtracks? Well, in one study that they did at NYU, researchers gave two different groups of students the same assignment. They said, hey, we want you to make sentences out of a collection of seemingly random words. And so they gave the group a big word bank, a bunch of words, and they said, hey, make some sentences. Both groups proceeded to make as many sentences as they could, but there was something slightly different about the words the second group of students was given. Hidden in that group of words were ideas that related to being old, words that indicated old age, words like bald and Florida and wrinkle were sprinkled throughout their collection of words. So at the end of the word challenge, the scientists told the participants, hey, we need you to walk down the hall to complete the second portion of the study. It's in another classroom, so walk down the hall. As they made their way down, the real test began. Scientists secretly timed the students to see how long it took them to make the short trip. And the students who had been exposed to the set of old age words walked slower. Is that the craziest thing you've ever heard? Just reading the words about being elderly caused a physical change in their bodies. This is a form of priming, which Nobel Prize winner Daniel Kahneman defines as the influencing of an action by the idea. The idea, the thought, impacts the action, which is amazing news for us because that means great thoughts lead to great actions. Great actions lead to great results. Your thoughts turn into actions, which turn into results. That's always how it goes. So if we want great results, if we want more joy in our lives, it behooves us to change the way we think and deal with our soundtracks. I've spent the last 2 years researching and writing a book called Soundtracks, and in working with thousands and thousands of people to change the way they think and add more joy to their lives, here's what we found. There are three things you need to do. Number one, you need to retire your broken soundtracks. Number two, you need to replace them with new soundtracks. And number three, you need to repeat the new ones until they become as automatic as the old ones. Retire, replace, and repeat. Can you tell I'm the son of a Southern Baptist pastor? Alliteration. We love alliteration. Retire, replace, repeat. Today, I'm going to teach you that first step. We're going to talk about what it takes to retire some broken soundtracks that are stealing your time, your creativity, and your joy. So let's start with a key Bible verse, 2 Corinthians 10:5. It says, "We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ." We are called to take every thought captive to make it obedient to Christ. So how do we actually do that in our lives? What does that really look like? Well, first, let's talk about a few examples of broken soundtracks. Here are some broken soundtracks you might have said, you might have heard. One could be, "I never stick to a diet. I never stick to a diet." That's a broken soundtrack. Or, "Everyone is a better mom than me." That's a broken soundtrack. "I've messed up too many times in the past. I can never change my future." That's a broken soundtrack. "Because I didn't have a good dad, I'm not equipped to be a good dad to my own kids." That's a broken soundtrack. "Things will always be this way. What's the point of trying?" That's a broken soundtrack. Right now, you're probably thinking of a few broken soundtracks that you've dealt with. If you're not, I'll give you a really easy way to identify one. Think about something that you want to do. I'm talking about a desire you have, a hope, a goal, a mission, a resolution. It could be anything. It could be, "I want to start a family. I want to pay off my student loans. I want to buy a house in Nashville. I hope you're a millionaire. I want to go back to school and get my degree. I want to lose 10 pounds. I want to trust God. I want to start my own company. I want to be in a small group where I really get to be known." Just write down any desire you have, big or small, and then listen. Listen to the first things you think about.
What are your first thoughts in that moment? What's your reaction? Why does that matter? Because every reaction is an education. Every reaction is an education, and chances are there are some broken soundtracks that'll surface in that moment. So how do we retire them? How do you take every thought captive and retire it? You start by asking your loudest soundtracks three simple questions. I'm talking about the soundtracks that are getting in the way. Think about it like your loudest boom boxes. You don't ask every thought you have these questions because you have 6,000 thoughts a day. Who has time for that? But you ask the loudest soundtracks three questions. Number one, is it true? Is it true? One of the greatest mistakes that we make is assuming all our thoughts are true. We tend to believe that if it's in our head, it must be accurate. If I think it, it must be real. Despite the wild things our thoughts have told us over the years, we still trust them. When you start to ask a soundtrack this question, I promise you'll be shocked by how many lies you have cluttering up your head. Is the story you're telling yourself about yourself true? Take the soundtrack, I'm the worst mom. Is that true? Was there a contest for worst moms and you won? Of all the moms, you're the worst? In the entire world, there was a vote and you were named the worst mom? That can't be true. It's probably Hitler's mom. That one was very easy. What about, it's too late for me to pursue my dream? Have you ever heard that one? It's too late. You missed your chance. It'll take too long. Your ship has already sailed. You're too old. The window is closed. You can't teach an old dog new tricks. Why bother? What's funny about that broken soundtrack is that when you're young, you'll hear, you don't have enough experience yet. You're too young. Who are you to think you can do that thing? And then you get older and your broken soundtrack switches to you're too old. And you think, wait a second. When was I the perfect age to do this thing? I was too young in my 20s, and now I'm too old in my 30s. That doesn't make any sense. It can't be true. That's the first question you ask. Is this thing I'm telling myself, this soundtrack I'm listening to, is it true? The second question you ask is it helpful? Is it helpful? Does listening to this soundtrack push you forward or pull you back? There might be a soundtrack that is true. For instance, maybe right now, the soundtrack you're hearing over and over again in your head is, it's really hard to buy a house in Nashville. That might be true. It is challenging right now. The real estate market here is bonkers. But is listening to that soundtrack on repeat helpful? Does telling yourself over and over and over again, it's really hard to buy a house in Nashville, it's really hard to buy a house in Nashville, does that encourage you? Does that fill you with joy? Every time you listen to that soundtrack, do you walk away energized and hopeful or exhausted and discouraged? Sometimes when I'm teaching people about overthinking, I'll get some really good pushback. People say, hey, I'm not an overthinker. I'm not overthinking. I'm just detailed. I like to be organized. I like to be analytical. And I love that. I think that's helpful. That is. Preparedness is great. I love preparedness. So what's the difference between being prepared and overthinking? It's easy. Preparedness always leads to action. Overthinking always leads to overthinking. If you're detailed, that always leads to an action. You launch the product. You send out the email. You respond to the customer. You ask the girl out. You get off the couch and you walk the mile in your neighborhood because you're gonna get in shape. There's a trail of actions behind you. But if you're overthinking broken soundtracks, that only leads to more overthinking. And all that time that you're wasting adds up. So ask yourself, is this soundtrack I'm listening to helpful? The third question we ask our broken soundtracks is this, is it kind? If I said what I'm saying to myself, to a friend, would they still wanna be my friend? I was being interviewed just the other day on a podcast, and when I taught the host this question, he kind of got quiet, and he said, oh no. And I said, what's wrong? And he said, well, I've had the number one podcast in my category for the last 9 months. It's doing really, really well, number one for 9 months. And the soundtrack that I've been listening to is, you're just lucky. You're just lucky. That's the only reason you're number one. You're just lucky. And he said, if my friend came over and had been working really hard on something for 9 months and it was successful, I'd never say to him, you're just lucky. If I wouldn't say that to a friend,
why am I saying it to myself? His soundtrack wasn't kind. Now, let's be honest. Let's be real. Of the three questions we ask our soundtracks, this is definitely the one that is most likely to conjure up holding a sprig of sage and chanting in a friendship circle at a commune in Malibu. But let's pump the brakes for a second. No one is saying you have to get touchy-feely to send a soundtrack through this final filter. In fact, let's dip back into the world of science to really grasp why retiring unkind soundtracks matters. So a few years ago, Google got curious and they wondered something. Google wondered, what do our most successful teams have in common? That's a good question, right? Some of our teams are outperforming others. I wonder why. What are they doing that's different? And how do we teach that to every other team we have? So they launched something called Project Aristotle. And Google spent millions of dollars studying this. They measured 180 different teams and they used 35 different statistical models. Now, in hindsight, it probably would have been a lot faster to just Google it, but if Google Googles itself, our solar system will collapse inward. I think that's true. Do you know what they found after this massive study? Do you know what they found? Google's data indicated there was one thing more than anything else that was critical to making a team work. Can you guess what it was? Psychological safety. What is psychological safety? Here's how it's defined. Psychological safety is a shared belief held by members of a team that the team is safe for interpersonal risk-taking. That's Amy Edmondson's definition. She's a Harvard Business School professor. And what it means is that on great teams, you can ask questions, suggest new ideas, and admit you're wrong. And here's the key. You can do all three of those things without being treated unkindly by the team. If you don't have psychological safety, people stop asking questions, they don't share their best ideas, and they never admit they are wrong. When you've got broken soundtracks firing shots at yourself all day, no wonder you get stuck. Your team of one isn't a safe place for growth or innovation. And when you ask that final question, is it kind? You're going to be surprised how many of your soundtracks really aren't. That was the funny thing about the research. We never found one person, not a single person, whose problem was that they were overthinking compliments. No one we studied said, yeah, my huge issue is that I keep overthinking what a good leader I am. I keep telling myself I'm a good mom. I keep overthinking how equipped I am for this new role I've been given at work. No one said that. In fact, they said the opposite in all areas of their life. Take business travel, for instance. That's starting to return. And a lot of people, myself included, have some broken soundtracks about that. Maybe right now you're a musician, you're like, I get that. I have to travel a bunch for my job. Or you're a roadie, you're a light guy, you're a light girl. Like, we have a lot of people in this city that travel for work. And so a few years ago, I started to do that. Why? Because I started my own company. And that was an amazing opportunity. But it also meant that I had to travel for work more often as I bounced around the world working with different companies. I went from 0 nights of business travel to about 80 nights a year. And when I first started leaving for trips, I would make a big production about my exit for my kids. I'd express remorse that I was leaving. I'd tell them how much I'd miss them. I'd say things like, I'll be home in 4 sleeps. I acted like I was being deployed to the moon for a year and not embarking on a 2-night stay at the DFW Courtyard Marriott. I should have just played Kansas's Dust in the Wind each time I packed my suitcase to put a chef's kiss on the whole scene. Finally, one night, my wife, Jenny, pulled me aside. She said, hey, you're making the kids feel terrible about you being gone. You feel guilty about it, so you're exaggerating the experience and teaching them to be sad. They don't even know to be sad. They don't. They don't even know to be sad about this, but they'll reflect your emotions. So the sadder you act, the sadder they feel. We're not mad that you're traveling. We're not crushed. It's your job. Go do your job. And Jenny was right. Kids will respond to our emotions. The process involves mirror neurons in their brains that reflect what you put out as a parent. When I heard the internal soundtrack, good dads don't do business travel, I felt sad. And in turn, taught my kids that they should feel sad too. Every time I traveled for work, I would feel like a failure because a broken soundtrack told me that over and over again. Good dads don't do business travel. It was a terrible feeling. But perhaps worse, like worse than that, was I was demonizing work. I was unknowingly teaching my kids that work was a terrible place that ripped you from your home and forced you to leave loved ones.
We spend 18 years teaching our kids that work sucks, and then we act surprised when they graduate from college and don't seem eager to get a job. I'd never thought about it, but in the background of my life, there were a few soundtracks that I was listening to that were telling me that. Good parents never travel for work. Good parents don't travel. And I should feel ashamed when I have to travel for work. Where did those come from? Well, my dad is a pastor, as I mentioned, and my mom's a dental hygienist. So I didn't grow up seeing parents travel for work. I thought, okay, I had good parents and they never traveled. Therefore, only bad parents travel. I'd accidentally believed those kind of soundtracks for years. But now that they were out in the open, I could ask them the three questions that I teach parents to ask all their broken soundtracks. And I realized it wasn't true, it wasn't helpful, and it wasn't kind. So I had to write a new soundtrack. Here's what I wrote. I don't have room for shame in my suitcase. I decided to stop packing shame on all of my trips. I just didn't have room for it. Those old soundtracks were no longer invited on the trip. I started telling anyone who would listen that they should let go of that too. When other business travelers would bemoan their absence from home, I would encourage them that beating yourself up rarely accomplishes anything useful. Retiring my broken soundtrack changed how I work. That's how you retire a broken soundtrack. You ask it three questions. Is the thing we're saying to ourselves, the thing we're believing, is it true? Is it helpful? Is it kind? If it's not, if you can't say yes to all three of those questions, you should retire it. And when you do, something amazing is going to happen. Once you discover the power of soundtracks, you're going to hear them everywhere. Individuals have soundtracks. Couples have soundtracks. Families have soundtracks. Teams have soundtracks. Companies have soundtracks. Even churches have soundtracks. What are some of our soundtracks here at Crosspoint? Well, you know them. Everyone's welcome. Nobody's perfect. Anything's possible. Those are the soundtracks that guide us. Those are the soundtracks that help us turn overthinking from a super problem into a superpower. Your thoughts can work for you, not against you. You can change the way you think about joy. You can renew your mind. You can take every thought captive. Not only that, you can actually live out what it says in Philippians 4:8. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. How do you do it? Remember, you retire your broken soundtracks. You replace them with new soundtracks, and you repeat the new ones until they become as automatic as the old ones. I've loved getting to share a few ideas with you today about what it looks like to renew your mind, to take thoughts captive, to have more joy, and I can't wait to see what you do with those ideas.
Wow, thank you so much, John. That was an amazing message. We really appreciate you sharing it with us today. Let's pray. God, we love you and thank you so much for who you are. We thank you that you care about us. You care about our hearts. You care about our souls. And you care about our minds as we learn today, God. I pray that you would help us to win the battle in our minds, that we can put aside the things that are not true for the things that are true. That those soundtracks that we may have in our minds that are false, God, I pray that you give us the courage to take those and replace them with what is true. God, give us the courage this week to go and to share this with a friend, if we need some accountability, God, I pray that you give us the courage to go and do that. God, thank you so much for your love and your mercy, and we just thank you so much for John, and we thank you for this message today. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you guys again for joining us, and we are so glad that you are here with us. Hey, if you're looking for some resources, you can pick up John's book at crosspoint.tv/joy. Every week during the summer when we're having these amazing speakers, you can go there and pick up some resources and maybe watch the message again. So I hope that you guys will go check that out. Have a great 4th of July, and we will see you next week.